some of you might have already heard my class during the crash course. Today I'm going to tell you something about few of the most intriguing, complicated topics of pediatrics. One of which is cerebral palsy. You might have studied, right? Hypertonic, hypertonic, akinetic, dyskinetic, dystonic, etoid, all these things. There are so many terms in cerebral palsy, which makes that small topic quite complicated. I actually have specific interest towards all these complicated topics, few of which are immune-mediated injuries, CNS, endocrine disorders, and cardiovascular disorders of pediatrics. Today we will basically see what exactly is cerebral palsy, what is the exact physiology and pathology behind cerebral palsy. Before we go into cerebral palsy, I would like you to know about few of the basic things of CNS. We all know CNS grossly has got cerebral cortex, cerebellum, brainstem, and thalamus. They are the four most important components of brainstem, your brain. In cerebral palsy, we have hyperkinetic CP. hypertonic CP and hypotonic CP. Before you understand CP, hypertonic, you need to understand what exactly is tone. What exactly is decreased tone or increased tone? To understand increased tone, let us assume a group of 100 soldiers. As you can see, the time is now 6:55 p.m. By 7:10, we'll done the tones. So let's assume that there are 100 soldiers. They had a party the previous night, they boozed well, and they're all sleeping. Suddenly, early in the morning, a terrorist or infiltrator creeps in. I command all soldiers, get up and fire. What do you think will be the firing pattern? Will it be uniform, regular, unified pattern of firing, or like erratic, haphazard pattern of firing? As we understand, it will be haphazard. Supposing all the soldiers are doing a drill, stand at this position with the guns in their hands. Suddenly, if an infiltrator comes and asks them to fire, they'll come to the initial position and they'll fire. Fine. 100 soldiers in stand at ease position firing will be a very good streamlined uniform firing, isn't it? The same thing happens in the muscle fibers. There are hundreds of muscle fibers in one union. They need to be in that partial state of contraction or partial state of readiness, what I call you as stand at ease position. When a nerve impulse brings a command of contraction, because all the muscles are already in the stand at ease position, they will contract smoothly, uniformly as one muscle group. So what I am trying to tell you today is, why is tone required? Tone is required for that smooth, coordinated group of activity across the various muscle fibers. So that partial state of readiness of a muscle is called tone. Now, there are two components, there are three components which influence tone. Okay, before we go into the two components or three components of the things that regulate tone, let me tell you simply. Cerebral cortex, cerebellum, extrapyramidal tracts, like your basal ganglia and spinal cord. The spinal reflex arc is so designed that it will keep on firing until it is completely increased 100% tone. But there are two persons who say, no, we don't need that much tone. Let us keep it to 30% contraction state, or let's keep it to 50% contraction state. That is cerebral cortex and the basal ganglia. when the spinal reflex arc from afferent to efferent, afferent to efferent, afferent to efferent, afferent to efferent, afferent is going on perpetually, the perpetual continuous spinal arc is called spinal reflex arc. Cerebral cortex says, no, stop. 30% of contraction enough for this muscle group. Similarly, basal ganglia also says, no, we need 30%, 40%, whatever. So these two members of the brainstem, they keep inhibiting this continual arc constantly. Whereas there's one person who says, spinal cord, you are doing a great job. Go ahead, increase it more and more and more. The facilitator of the tone is cerebellum. Cerebellum is the one which supports and facilitates the spinal reflex arc. So that forms us the part of the importance of tone. You might have seen, if we take a single muscle group without any tone, flabby muscles, superimposing a muscle activity will be very difficult. It will be haphazard, just like stimulating the muscle group cut in the experiments, you know. But if the muscle group is in partial readiness, like partial contraction, then if you impose a nerve impulse saying that, okay, contract, it will be smooth contraction of muscle group. So in these 5 minutes, we understood the importance of the concept of the need for maintenance of tone and the components which help maintain tone and decrease tone. Okay? Before you understand very well the basal ganglia, I would like to elaborate a bit what exactly is basal ganglia. To understand basal ganglia, let me give a small example of the anatomy of brainstem, which encompass basal ganglia. Very simple. Suppose I am brainstem. Brainstem is midbrain, pons, medulla. Fine? I hang a bag, that becomes cerebellum. As you can see, cerebellum overlies pons. Okay? The bag has these little bells, which are called middle cerebellar peduncles. Ammail pelakalaga in ostayindi, they form superior cerebellar peduncles. Back in the talkala untai kada, they are the inferior cerebellar peduncles. To mean to say, cerebellum can never give independent commands. It has to go through one of the brainstem structures to command, carry out its command, like cerebello, rubro, spinal tract, cerebello, ponto, spinal tracts, whatever. So that's about cerebellum, pons, middle of longata, and midbrain. Rendu gudlu pedta undi paina, two eggs on the head. That is what thalamus. It's not vertically, it's horizontally laid. Eggs. Sai Baba hair lanti pedda hair in the vagostha. That is cerebral cortex. Okay, very simple indeed. You can see that cerebral cortex covers midbrain and some part of the pons and is in continuum with the cerebellum. Fine. So thalamus lo kinda part, this is subthalamic nuclei, substantia nigra of midbrain. The black part of midbrain is substantia nigra. These two parts and caudate nucleus. You can imagine caudate nucleus like an E-shaped jalebi, which is placed just a bit parallel to the thalamus. If you do it longer only. So, an E-shaped jalebi, subthalamic nuclei, and substantia nigra. These four things form the components of basal ganglia. Bread slice laga, Japanese fan laga, pet the fan. It all gets condensed in the E-shaped jalebi and goes down the brainstem, corticospinal tracts. Okay, I can tell you better anatomy with a blackboard behind me, but for time being, I hope most of you got the structure of brainstem and the components of basal ganglia and the functions and modalities of what regulates tone and why do we require tone. I will pause here.